Well, you cast out and across, and you try to attain a dead drift, and then when it starts to pull directly away from you, you can mend. You can extend that swimming period with a fly. There's gonna come a point in any drift where you're gonna run out of room, you're gonna run out of places to mend, and at that point, the fly is just gonna start swinging around on the taut line. What happens, a lot of times you'll get a strike on that taut line, and you'll feel it, you know, and you'll pluck, pluck. What happens?
Tap.
Right, the fish is just trying to suck it in, and he's pulling against the taut line, and he never gets it in his mouth. What you wanna do when that fly starts swinging is you wanna start stripping, and stripping fast. It's amazing how fast a fish can move when he wants something. When a fly is moving that fast, the fish knows that he can't just suck it, that he has to really wrap it.
Right.
Right, and I think you'll not only get more strikes, but you'll get a greater percentage of hookups, a much greater percentage of hookups.
And those nymphs will really swim that fast?
Oh yeah, there are caddis, pupa that actually emerge. They'll emerge underwater, they'll come to the surface, but they'll swim all the way under the surface across the stream, especially on a big flat slick like that. You have a lot of those big ones that react in that manner. And they can motor. They can really motor, and the fish will get very aggressive when they see them.
Now you're swinging around.
And I'm not only using the force of the current, but I'm also giving it quite a bit of pull going in.
All right.
So if I know if I'm going to get a hit there, I'm going to hook them.
You decide to let it swing naturally. How can you increase your hookups?
Well, you do get those tap taps, and there is one slick little trick. And this is a trick that I've known since boyhood on Connecticut streams like salmon brook, where you'd get a lot of those. You take the line and you take a loop of it, and you hold it right at the barest tip of your fingertips as the line is swinging around. And when a fish hits, there isn't enough there to hold it, and so boom, it pulls it out of your hand, it pulls the slack from your fingers, it drops the fly back into his mouth, and he closes his mouth, and then you strike. Just strike naturally, just a very simple reflex. And it's a neat little trick for hooking fish. I'll do it a lot on brook trout, on small streams.
The first thing you have to decide as a nymph fisherman is how you're gonna get your fly down to the bottom. What happens when an insect breaks free from the bottom is that there's dead current right in between the rocks. And then above that, you have the unobstructive flow of the main river. But between those two, you have an interface. You have a joining where the currents mix. And when an insect drifts, that's where 90% of the food is. You have to get your fly down into that interface. And the way that you have to do it is with weight. If you're gonna be fishing near the bottom, you have to pick either a very heavy hook, or else you have to put lead on the fly, or else you have to put lead on the leader. I sometimes use all three methods. Once I do cast it out, I'm gonna get the fly up, I'm gonna get the line up, I'm gonna have it drifting dead towards me so that the fly can sink close to the bottom, and I'm gonna try to keep contact without pulling on it. Dead drift nymph technique, deadly.
You know, we've been fishing the Green River the last couple of days, Gary, and I've been watching these nymphs being drifted. Talk to me a little about behavioral drift. I know that's a big part of your book.
It's a big part of fishing, not just of the book or with caddis flies, but with mayflies, stoneflies. I wrote about behavioral drift first in Fly Fisherman magazine in my old Primer of Entomology column. That was the first column I wrote. And it was significant. And everybody said, wow, you mean we could actually predict when the nymphs are going to be drifting? And you can't. What happens is that stoneflies and mayflies, basically, they'll drift at night. And the reason for behavioral drift is they just want to move to scatter to new areas. Caddis flies, especially case caddis flies, drift basically during the day. So if I'm going to be out on a river with a searching pattern, I'm going to put on a case caddis. That's what I'm going to use right up and through till dusk.